Hello everyone! For those who don't know me, my name is Anwar Bayer. Glad to see you on my channel Biocolta and welcome to my SAT Biology course. If you haven't watched my first video, be sure to check it out. I explained the format of the exam there, answered some frequently asked questions and gave a couple of tips that will come in handy for you to get 800 points for this exam. And so let's move on to our second lesson called Biological Chemistry. This is one of the most important topics that you should be familiar with. Ask why? This is because biochemistry is a foundation without which you cannot do. And besides, many of the following lessons will be indirectly or directly related to this topic. Before we begin, let's take a look at what this lesson includes. I divided this lesson into two videos, where the stage will discuss with you basic atomic structure, bonding, characteristics of water and pH scale. And already in the second part, we will dwell in more detail on the four main types of macromolecules. That is, we have carbohydrates, fats, proteins and nucleic acids, DNA and RNA. So, now take a closer look. The first aspect is basic chemistry. In this section, we'll try to understand what it is. And so, let's answer four basic questions. What is the atom? What are the molecules? What are the compounds? And what are the elements? Atoms are the smallest unit of matter, or as you can see, they are the fundamental units of the physical world. Individual atoms combine in chemical reactions to form molecules. In other words, molecules are just a combination of atoms. However, it's worth noting that, depending on which atoms are included in the composition, we distinguish two categories. Suppose, if a molecule contains only a single type of atom, then it is an element. And if a molecule contains different types of atoms, it is called a compound. For example, H2 is an element because it consists of one type of atom, hydrogen. While H2O is already an example of compound, since it consists of two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom. Also, I would like to remind you that in chemical reactions, the molecules or atoms that are interacting are called reactants and are found on the left side of the arrow. The products, the results of the interactions, are found on the right side of the arrow. For instance, as you can see from the slide, the H2 and O2 are reactants and the water molecule is already a product. Next, let's look at the structure of an atom. It consists of three subparticles, namely proton, neutron and electron. Moreover, all of them have differences in three main fields, such as charge, placement and mass. So, the first two are located in the nucleus of the atom, and the third in the atomic orbital. Each proton has one unit of positive charge, and each electron has one unit of a negative charge, while a neutron, as its name implies, is electrical neutral. And finally, the table shows the distinctions in values of their mass, where the proton and neutron are characterized by weight of 1 mu, and the electron doesn't have it at all. Let's move on. Here you can see four main properties that you have to know regarding the atoms. First, an atom in the elemental state always has a neutral charge because the number of protons equals the number of electrons. Second, the electron configuration is important because it determines how a particular atom will react with atoms of other elements. Third, electrons in the lowest available energy level are said to be in the ground state. And last but not least, is when an atom absorbs energy, its electrons move to a higher energy level. The atom is then said to be in the excited state. Isotopes. Isotopes are atoms of one element that vary only in the number of neutrons in the nucleus, and therefore have greater mass. Chemically, all isotopes of the same element are identical because they have the same number of electrons. For example, carbon 12 and carbon 14 are isotopes of each other and are chemically identical. They both possess 6 protons and 6 electrons. However, carbon 12 has 6 neutrons while carbon 14 has 8 neutrons. Some isotopes like carbon 14 are radioactive. The nuclei of radioisotopes emit particles and decay at a known rate called a half-life. Knowing the half-life enables us to measure the age of fossils or to estimate the age of Earth, and they can be used in medical diagnosis, treatment and research. For example, radioactive iodine can be used both to diagnose and to treat certain diseases of thyroid gland. Also, radioactive carbon can be used as a tracer incorporated into molecules of carbon dioxide and used to track metabolic pathways. I believe it's pretty simple. The second aspect is bonding. We have two main groups, namely intramolecular attractions, which are inside the molecule between atoms, and intermolecular attractions, which are between two or more molecules. The first group consists of ionic bonds and covalent bonds, while the second group includes in itself polar-polar attractions, hydrogen bonding, and van der Waals interactions. Ionic bond. In some cases, two atoms are so unequal in their attraction for valence electrons that the more electronegative atom strips an electron completely away from its partner. The two resulting oppositely charged atoms or molecules are called ions. A positively charged ion is called a cation, while a negatively charged ion is called anion. Because of their opposite charges, cations and anions attract each other. This attraction is called an ionic bond. And compounds formed are called ionic compounds or salts. A common example is sodium chloride crystal. Note that the transfer of an electron isn't by itself the formation of a bond. Rather, it allows a bond to form because it results in two ions of opposite charge. Any two ions of positive charge can form an ionic bond. The ions do not need to have acquired their charge by an electron transfer with each other. Covalent bond. It is a type of bond which is simply the sharing of a pair of valence electrons by two atoms. According to the number of shared valence electron pairs, namely 1, 2 or 3, the bonds can be called single, double or triple bonds respectively. Moreover, we can divide the covalent bonds in two, either polar or non-polar covalent bonds. Here is the table. Please pause the video and read the information carefully by yourself. Okay. In general, I want to say that nonpolar covalent bonds are only for diatomic elements. To memorize them, we use one phrase, namely Hofbräunkel, which stands for hydrogen, oxygen, fluorine, bromine, iodine, nitrogen and fluorine. Additionally, you need to understand why equal or unequal sharing occurs. It is because of the differences in electronegativity of two atoms, which is defined as tendency to obtain electrons. So, if there is no difference in electronegativity, then the electron pair would be halfway between two atoms. It is because, as I mentioned before, they are diatomic or consist of the same atoms, so logically, they need to pull electrons in equal manner. Thus, they are properties of nonpolar molecules. What about the polar molecules? There are differences in electronegativity, so that one atom pulls harder than the other atom, resulting in partial plus or minus charge. Polar-polar attractions appear if these molecules are polar or unbalanced. The overall mechanism looks like the negative end of one polar molecule attracts the positive end of another polar molecule, or vice versa, for example between water molecules. Next is hydrogen bonding. It is an attraction between hydrogen and electronegative atom nearby, namely oxygen, nitrogen or fluoride, for example H2O and ammonia, where the bond forms between hydrogen and nitrogen. Let me explain. Even a molecule with nonpolar covalent bonds may have positively and negatively charged regions. Why? Because electrons aren't always evenly distributed. At any instant, they may accumulate by chance in one part of a molecule or another. The results are ever-changing regions of positive and negative charge that enable all atoms and molecules to stick to one another. Then it is called van der Waals interactions. These interactions are individually weak and occur only when atoms and molecules are very close together. However, when many such interactions occur simultaneously, they can be powerful. The third aspect is water. Water is asymmetrical and very polar. It also has strong nonpolar covalent bonds, strong intermolecular attractions and strong hydrogen bonding. Together, these last two forces are responsible for the special characteristics of water that affect life on Earth. Specifically, you have to know the structure of water molecule and understand the main trends, namely which bonds are there inside the molecules as well as between them. For this purpose, I have included the picture, where the main key points are summarized. Please pause the video, look at this picture and the inserted text carefully. Apart from the structure, you have to be able to answer questions related to the properties of water. H2O has six characteristics. First, water has high specific heat. Second, water has a high heat of vaporization. Third, water has a high adhesion properties. Fourth, water is a universal solvent. Fifth, water exhibits strong cohesion tension. And sixth, ice floats because it's less dense than water. For more information, why does water have these properties? You should look at the 55th page of the parents' book. So, let's move on to our last aspect for today's video, namely pH scale. What is it? The pH scale is a measure of acidity and alkalinity of a solution. Particularly, it has 0 to 14 points scale. The pH of a solution is defined as a negative logarithm base 10 of the hydrogen ion concentration. Visually, it is represented as the following. Where the square brackets mean concentration of something. However, I believe that this formula is unnecessary. Unless you are writing an SAT subject in chemistry. Instead, you need to be concentrated on the general idea of pH scale. So, firstly you have to know regions on the scale. If the value is less than 7, it is an acidic solution. If the value is greater than 7, it is a basic solution. And if the value is equal to 7, it is a neutral solution. Secondly, you must be able to write dissociation and association equations for water molecules, because they express important behavior. Specifically, they can behave both as an acid and base. Thirdly, remember that each pH unit represents a tenfold difference in hydrogen and hydroxide ions concentration. We can infer this information from this table, which is divided into two. namely pH value and the corresponding concentration of hydrogen ions in moles per liter. For instance, you will consider the pH of value 1 and value 2. For the first one, the concentration of hydrogen ions would be 0.1 molar. And for the second one, it is 0.01 molar. Thus, we can see the trend we are discussing. In other words, if you increase the pH by 1 unit, then the concentration of protons will decrease tenfold, or vice versa. A similar trend can be seen in the change of concentration of hydroxide ions, which instead starts to decrease by tenfold from 14 pH. In summary, the highest concentration of hydrogen ions at 0 pH, while for the hydroxide ions, it is 14 pH. And fourthly, you have to know that the internal pH of most living cells is close to 7. This value is maintained by using the buffers. They are substances that help us to resist the changes in pH, which work by absorbing excess hydrogen ions or donating hydrogen ions when there are too few. Specifically, several buffers contribute to pH stability in human blood and many other biological solutions. One of these is carbonic acid, which is formed when CO2 reacts with water in blood plasma. To know how it works, just pause the video and look at the diagram on the right side. Okay, on this our second lesson ended. As usual, I will leave a link at the description to download today's slide and books. I hope it was most useful for you. And if you haven't subscribed yet, then be sure to be subscribed today. Press like and share this channel with your friends. I will be waiting for you in the next lesson. Всем большое рахмет!